Collins English Readers. The Witness for the Prosecution and Other Stories by Agatha Christie. Text copyright Agatha Christie Limited 2017. Recording copyright HarperCollins Publishers 2017. Read by Roger May and Gabrielle Glaister. The Witness for the Prosecution. Mr. Mayhern was a small man. He had clever grey eyes, wore good quality clothes, and he always looked neat and tidy. Everybody knew that he was a very good lawyer. Mayhern touched his glasses and coughed. He always did this when he was thinking. Then he looked again at the man sitting opposite him, the man charged with murder. He felt a little sorry for his client. "This is very serious. You must be completely honest with me." Leonard Vole looked at him miserably. "I know," he said in a hopeless voice. "You keep telling me that it's serious, but I just can't believe that I'm charged with murder. Murder!" "Yes, yes, yes," he said. Mayhern was not emotional. He was a sensible man. He coughed again, took off his glasses, cleaned them carefully, and put them back on his nose. "Now, my dear Mr. Vole, I'm going to try very hard to prove that you're innocent, and I will succeed. We will succeed. But I must have all the facts." The young man still looked at him in the same confused, hopeless way. "You think I'm guilty," said Leonard Vole. "But I promise I'm not. I didn't do it, Mr. Mayhern. I didn't." Even though Mr. Mayhern knew that any man in his position would say the same, he thought maybe Leonard Vole might really be innocent. "You're right, Mr. Vole," he said in a serious voice. "The case against you looks very bad, but I believe you. Now, let's talk about the facts. I want you to tell me exactly how you met Miss Emily French."
"It was in central London. I saw an elderly lady crossing the road. She was carrying a lot of parcels, and she dropped them in the middle of the street. She tried to pick them up, but a bus came along and she had to rush to the pavement. Then I picked up the parcels for her."
"Did you save her life?"
"Oh, no. All I did was pick up the parcels, but she was very grateful. She thanked me and said something about me being more helpful than most young people. I can't remember the exact words. I said goodbye and went on with my day. I never expected to see her again. But life is full of surprises. That same evening, I met her again at a party. She recognised me. I then found out that she was Miss Emily French and that she lived at Cricklewood. I talked to her for a while. I think Emily French was a lady who decided quickly whether she liked someone. She decided that she liked me because I had helped her, but anyone would have done the same. She asked me to come and visit her sometime. I said, of course, that I would. I didn't particularly want to go, but it would have been rude to refuse. She asked me when, so I said I would go the following Saturday. After she'd gone, my friends told me that she was rich and that she lived alone with just a maid."
"I see," said Mayhern. "So you knew she was rich soon after you'd met her?"
Leonard Vole was angry.
"If you mean, did I ask if she was rich?" he began. But Mayhern interrupted him.
I have to look at the case the way the prosecution will explain it in court. Miss French didn't look rich. She didn't spend much money or have many things. Unless someone told you, you would probably have thought that she was poor. Who was it who told you that she had money?
My friend George Harvey. It was his party.
Will he remember telling you?
I really don't know. It was a while ago.
Mr. Vole, the prosecution will show that you needed money. That is true, isn't it?
Leonard Vole looked embarrassed.
Yes, he said quietly.
So, they'll say you needed money and you met this rich old lady and tried hard to develop a friendship with her. Now, if we can say that you didn't know that she was rich and that you visited her to be kind,
which is true,
I'm sure it is. But remember, I'm looking at it like the prosecution will do. So it's important to know what Mr. Harvey remembers. Is he likely to remember that conversation or not? Could we make him think that the conversation took place later?
Leonard Vole thought for a moment. Then he said,
No, I don't think that that would be successful, Mr. Mahon. Several people heard him tell me at the party.
The lawyer tried to hide his disappointment.
That's unfortunate, he said. But thank you for being honest, Mr. Vole. You're quite right, that won't work. So, you met Miss French, you visited her at her home, and a friendship developed. We need to give a good reason for all this. Why did you, a young man of 33, good-looking, good at sports, popular with your friends, spend so much time with an elderly woman? You must have had hardly anything in common.
Leonard Vole looked nervous.
I don't know. I really don't know. After the first visit, she asked me to come again. It was clear that she liked me. She said she was lonely and unhappy, so it was difficult to say no. You see, Mr. Mahon, I'm one of those people who can't say no. And believe it or not, after the third or fourth visit, I really did start to like her. My mother died when I was young, and I was brought up by an aunt who died before I was 15. If I told you that I enjoyed her acting like a mother to me, I think you'd laugh.
Mahon didn't laugh. Instead, he took off his glasses again and cleaned them. This was always a sign that he was thinking.
I believe you, Mr. Vole, he said at last. I just don't know whether a jury would. Please, continue. When did Miss French first ask for your advice about business?
After my third or fourth visit. She didn't understand very much about money and was worried about some investments.
Mahon looked up quickly.
Be careful, Mr. Vole. The maid, Janet McKenzie, says that Miss French was a good businesswoman and her bank manager agrees.
I can't help that, said Vole seriously. That's what she said to me.
This answer made Mahon believe Leonard Vole even more. He knew a little about elderly ladies. He could imagine Miss French enjoying the company of the good-looking young man, trying to find reasons for him to visit her. Of course she would say that she didn't understand business and ask him to help her. She knew that most men liked to be asked for help. Leonard Vole had liked being asked. Perhaps she had wanted this young man to know that she was rich. Perhaps Emily French had been willing to pay for what she wanted. All these thoughts passed quickly through Mayhern's mind, but he didn't show it. Instead, he asked another question.
And did you help her when she asked you to?
I did.
Mr. Vole, said the lawyer, I'm going to ask you a very serious question, and it's important that you tell me the truth. You needed money. You were helping an old lady with her investments, an old lady who said she knew little or nothing about business. Did you at any time, or in any way, move any of Emily French's investments or money to your own accounts? Now, wait a minute before you answer. We have two options. Either we concentrate on you being honest, we explain that it's unlikely that you would murder Miss French, as you could have easily taken her money anyway. However, if the prosecution can prove that you swindled the old lady in any way, we must instead say that you had no reason to murder her, since you already had her money. Do you understand the difference? Now, please think carefully before you answer. But Leonard Vole answered quickly. I did not swindle Miss French.
Thank you, said Mayhern. I'm pleased to hear that. I know that you're far too clever to lie to me about such an important thing.
Good. So, said Vole with excitement, the strongest point in my case is that I have no reason to have hurt her. Yes, I developed a friendship with a rich old lady. Yes, I suppose I hoped to get some money from a friendship with her. But isn't it clear that her death has ended all my hopes?
The lawyer looked at him seriously. Then he repeated his habit of cleaning his glasses. He didn't speak until they were back on his nose.
Do you not know, Mr. Vole, that Miss French left a will, and that in her will she leaves most of her money to you?
What? The prisoner jumped to his feet.
What are you saying? She left her money to me?
Mayhern nodded his head slowly. Vole sat down again. He put his head in his hands.
You didn't know anything about this will?
No, I knew nothing about it.
What would you say if I told you that the maid, Janet Mackenzie, says that you did know? She says that Miss French told her that she had talked to you about it.
What would I say? Leonard Vole repeated. I'll say that she's lying. No, that isn't fair. Janet loved Miss French, and she didn't like me. She was jealous and suspicious of me. Perhaps Miss French told Janet what she was going to do, and Janet either didn't understand properly or convinced herself that I had persuaded the old lady to do it.
Do you think she dislikes you enough to lie in court?
Leonard Vole looked shocked.
No, why would she? I don't know, said Mayhern, but she really doesn't like you.
I'm beginning to see, Leonard Vole said quietly. The prosecution will say that I encouraged the friendship, that I got her to make a will leaving her money to me, and then that I went to her house that night and there was nobody else there. Then they find her dead the next day. Oh, it's awful.
You're wrong about there being nobody else in the house, said Mayhern,
moving the conversation on.
Janet was planning to go out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.